The tabletop role-playing game Dungeons & Dragons uses the D20, the 20-sided die, to determine things like whether your character lands an attack, whether they succeed at using an ability, or whether they save against an effect. You have to add modifiers to the roll which depend on your character and the current situation, and then the result is compared to a target value, usually called a difficulty class or DC. If the result is equal to or greater than the DC, then you succeed, and if it's lower, then you fail and suffer the consequences. Now, having tons of modifiers from lots of different effects is often annoying to add up on the fly, so in 5th edition, the most recent edition of Dungeons & Dragons, many of these modifiers have been replaced with a different system called advantage and disadvantage. If you have advantage, you roll 2 dice and take the highest number, and if you have disadvantage, then you roll 2 dice and take the lowest. Modifiers do still exist for things like character traits, since they don't change very often and are easier to keep track of, but almost all temporary effects have been replaced by advantage and disadvantage. Are you hidden from someone? Then you have advantage on attacks against them. Are you swinging your sword at someone while lying on the floor? Then you have disadvantage. The benefit of this system is that it's very easy for the DM to extend it to novel situations not covered by the rules. The detriment is that it's less flexible and only has 3 modes. A reasonable question here is, how good is advantage? If we were to convert it to a flat modifier, what would that modifier be? Is it a +2? A +4? Well, it's not really comparable, because it has a different effect depending on the difficulty class. One of the quirks of flat modifiers is that if you have a bonus that's big enough, it might actually be impossible to fail a check. If the difficulty class is 15 and your modifier is 14, then even if you roll a 1, you still succeed. There are actually some other mechanics in the game which can make this relatively common. If you play a rogue, you get an ability at level 11 which prevents you from rolling below a 10 on any ability your character is proficient in, which in a lot of circumstances means you physically can't fail. But this will never happen with advantage or disadvantage. If both success and failure are possible initially, then they're still possible after either advantage or disadvantage. So let's do this. Let's write P for the probability you succeed a roll normally. So for example, to pass a DC of 16 with a modifier of 5, you need to roll 11 or higher, so the probability P is 50%. If you have disadvantage, then the probability you succeed is P squared, because you need to succeed on both rolls. For advantage, you only fail if you fail both rolls, so the chance of failure is 1 minus P all squared, and then the chance of success is 1 minus that. We can then expand and simplify to get 2P minus P squared. Now, we want to convert these to modifiers. What bonus do I need in order to get from a success probability of P to this new value? Since we're using 20-sided dice, we just need to take the difference and multiply by 20. If we now graph the modifier against the probability P, we get this graph for advantage and this one for disadvantage. So it looks like advantage is most powerful when the original probability is 50%, where it corresponds to a modifier of +5 for advantage or -5 for disadvantage. But importantly, this depends on the DC. If the DC is very high, and the initial probability of success is only around 20 or 30%, then the bonus of advantage is only about +3 or +4, and the same happens for easy checks of an initial success around 70 or 80%. I've seen a lot of discussion in various online posts which go through the same calculations, but as usual with probability, most people miss out these important details. One thing that a lot of people do is average all the possibilities with a uniform distribution and state that the average roll on the higher of 2d20s is 13.825. This would give a modifier of +3.325. Note that the average roll on a single d20 is actually 10.5 and not 10, confusingly. However, this is making the bold assumption that all difficulty classes appear equally often, which is not true at all. You're typically going to run into obstacles that match your player level, which means you're more likely to have a fairly even chance of succeeding checks against them, and it's very rare to run into checks that are either almost impossible or almost trivial. So you might then think that 1/2 is the right figure to start from, and so advantage is equivalent to a +5 bonus. But that's not right either. The actual most common probability is likely to be a bit higher. This is partly because you're probably going to be making checks with skills that your character is proficient in and leave things that you're bad at to the other players, but it's also because if you're the dungeon master, then in a lot of situations it makes sense to make all of your enemies have bad defenses and a lot of hit points, so that players will land attacks more often and have more fun. So for a lot of campaigns, the actual median hit probability is probably around 65 or 70%, so the equivalent modifier for advantage is probably around a +4. But is it really correct to say advantage is the strongest when the base probability is 50%? I mean, sure, the difference in probability is greater, but should we really be using the difference? What if we used multiplication instead of addition? If we start with a 50% probability, advantage takes you up to 75%, which is a factor of 1.5. If you instead start with a measly 10% probability, advantage takes you to 19%. Additively, that's not as much, but multiplicatively, it's almost double the starting value. At the other end, if you start with a 90% probability, then advantage takes you to 99%, which is a lot, but not a great deal bigger than 90. So, using this metric, advantage is stronger when your initial chance of success is lower, with very small probabilities getting approximately doubled, and high ones not affected by much. But that doesn't really feel right to me. As someone who plays Pokemon games, I would consider 99% probability of success to be significantly better than 90%, and this isn't captured by either addition or multiplication. What if we flip everything around and use the chance of failure instead? If the chance of success is 90%, then the chance of failure is 10%, and advantage takes this to just 1%. Advantage multiplies the success chance by only a little, but it divides the failure chance by 10, a much bigger quantity. And as you look at smaller and smaller probabilities, this factor gets bigger and bigger asymptotically. What I've realized from this is that when we say something like twice as likely, there isn't actually a precise universal meaning for that. Just the literal statement of multiply the probability by 2 doesn't make sense for probabilities greater than the half. Maybe for these cases, we actually mean that the chance of the complementary outcome is half as much. In which case, the better thing to use would be odds. Let's say a check has a 75% chance of succeeding. We could say that the probability is 3 in 4, or we could say that the odds are 3 to 1 in favor. This means the chance of succeeding is 3 times the chance of failing. If we repeated this dice roll many times, we would expect there to be 3 times as many successes as failures. The interesting thing about odds is that these two numbers can be any positive numbers. To get the actual probability from them, we need to add them to get the total which they are fractions of. This allows us to make sense of the statement twice as likely without running into issues. For example, starting at 75%, twice the odds would become 6 to 1 in favor, which is 86%. The cool thing about this approach is that it works at both extremes. If the initial probability of success is small, then twice the odds is approximately twice the probability of success. But if the probability is close to 1, then twice the odds is approximately halving the probability of failure. In the middle, there's a compromise. 50% probability is 1 to 1 odds, so twice the odds would be 2 to 1, which is a 2 in 3 chance of success. So how do advantage and disadvantage change the odds? A little bit of algebra gives us the answer. For very small probabilities, advantage doubles the odds. At 50%, advantage triples the odds. And at higher probabilities, advantage increases the odds even more. So it actually is as imbalanced as we saw before. Advantage makes unlikely checks only slightly more likely, but it makes likely checks almost certain. Modifiers, on the other hand, are even weirder. Since modifiers can make impossible checks possible and make likely checks impossible to fail, the change in odds shoots off to infinity at both ends. It's also important to recognize that a lot of the time when we say things like twice as likely, we're referring to very small probabilities, like the chance of contracting a disease or winning the lottery. And for these small probabilities, there isn't a problem with twice as likely being badly defined. The three operations of doubling the probability, doubling the odds, and taking advantage are all approximately equal when the initial probability is close to zero, and that's because these functions all have the same first-order Taylor expansion, if you know what that is. And even though double odds might make more sense mathematically, I think when we say twice as likely, we often mean advantage because it's literally twice as many opportunities to get the result you want. So what have we learned? Firstly, you need to be careful about how probabilities depend on all the different factors involved, and sometimes reducing things down to a single number isn't appropriate. Secondly, seemingly intuitive concepts like twice as likely only make sense in certain contexts, and otherwise can have multiple interpretations. And finally, if we really want to equate advantage to a flat modifier, it's around a +4, but might be more or less depending on what it's being used for. If you're weighing up character options, then to do it properly, you should estimate the likely DCs you're going to want to pass with the check you're using, and evaluate the improvement in success rate using that. Or you could just not over-engineer your character like an absolute nerd.